So, good evening, students. Can you all hear me? Okay. If you find any technical issues, no, kindly let me know as and then. Otherwise, I'll be unknowingly presenting, imagining that you people are online and things are going on well. Yes? Fine. So, anyway, in the last class, I have discussed about the this one. Which one? African sleeping sickness, right? And it is caused by which one? What is the organism that has caused that? That is Trypanosoma brucei. So the Trypanosoma brucei complex, that is the one which causes African sleeping sickness, right? And that African sleeping sickness is of how many types? Two types. One is East, another is West African sleeping sickness, right? Are you all clear with this? And very important is that we may divide and say that it is East or West African sleeping sickness, but the organism that is responsible or the parasite that is responsible, it is morphologically and antigenically almost all same, but only difference is with the what? With the clinical manifestation. And all these things we have already seen in the previous class. So today I'll be discussing about one of the very important what the sleeping sickness that is caused by the same Trypanosoma, but this time a different subspecies we'll be discussing because it has got a different clinical manifestation or presentation. So that is what called by the name Chagas disease. It is also called as South American trypanosomiasis. So now looking at this name itself, South American trypanosomiasis. So what one first point it should strike to your mind? Sirisha, Suchet, Sakshi and others, Yadgiri. So now just looking at that particular thing, like the name itself, South American, or else just try to eliminate the South also. Just look at the thing, American. So what does it say from our community medicine point of view? Is it epidemic or is it endemic in nature or is it pandemic in nature? So what is the nature of this particular parasitic infection?
Endemic.
All of you agree with this point? Because no, endemic means what? Here, the disease is constantly present in a defined geographic area. Throughout the year, anytime we go, no, like a few, some or the other cases related to this particular problem, all the time we can see. So constantly, maybe the intensity may be low, but all the time it is present in the defined geographic area. So whenever any disease, it mentions African, American, or maybe like East or West, whatever the names, the geographic names it is associated with, the first point you have to remember that it is always endemic in nature. Yes? Now, hopefully if you all try to recollect in the last class what I told you, what does this particular Trypanosoma cruzi, this particular organism, like it belongs to what? Let us see a little bit about its background actually. It's what parasitic information. Is it multicellular or is it unicellular? Suchet, Sirisha, others. What is the nature of this particular Trypanosoma cruzi? Yadgiri, am I audible? Sirisha,
yes, ma'am.
Okay. So it is basically what? It is basically unicellular. That means only one cell it has got. Okay, it is unicellular. So look at this. It has got only one cell and it is causing such a huge problem, such a critically dangerous fellow he is. Then what is another important thing? He is a flagellated fellow. He has got what? What is the organ of locomotion? That is flagella over here. Because in amoeba and all, what is the organ of locomotion? It is Pseudopodia. But this fellow has got what? He has got very important organism of locomotion, that is flagella, that is a whip-like structure or the extension. Yes, then where does this particular fellow, he love to live? He lives in the blood. So which is a favorite habitat for this? That is a blood. So how can we express this Trypanosoma cruzi? Yes. Is it a hemoflagellate? Yes or no? It is a hemoflagellate, right? So if you want to describe this particular organism, so it is a basically what? Protozoan, and it is a unicellular in nature, and it has got a flagella as its organ of locomotion, and its favorite habitat, the favorite place to reside is which one? Blood. That's why we call it as what? Hemoflagellate. And then what is the important structure it has got? What is the important structure it has got? See here, somewhere in the middle of its body, it has got a large nucleus. It has got what? A large nucleus. Then apart from that, no, it has got one very important other structure. So what is that? That is called as kinetoplast. Yes, kinetoplast. So yeah, Suchet, did you remember this kinetoplast?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, now from this kinetoplast, what will arise? The flagellum will arise, right? And this flagella, what will happen? It will just pass along the body of this particular organism. Now, as it passes along the body of its this particular trypanosoma, there is one thin transparent membrane that tries to connect this flagellum and its body. So this membrane, we call it as what? Undulating membrane. It is called as what? Undulating membrane. So it is a one particular organism. Very characteristic feature is what? It has got a kinetoplast and it has got a undulating membrane. So these are its one basic characteristic features. Yes, are you all clear? So the Chagas disease, it is also called as what? South American, or simply we can call it as American sleeping sickness. Now students, one point I want to stress you over here. Here, look at the name, sleeping. So the name itself is saying sleeping, but sleeping is not the major issue over here, as we have seen in the African sleeping sickness. There, the sleeping is itself is a very important clinical or the pathognomic feature in the later stages, right? But here, the person, even though he is infected, but the sleeping is not the major feature over here. So he has got other important problems over here. So especially it affects which one? Heart. And it affects, the very important is GIT. So these are the two important structures which are basically damaged in this Chagas disease. So what is the organism that is responsible, students? It is a Trypanosoma cruzi, right? Now, how do you describe? Because in the MCQs or in your theory paper also, you need to give few what classic information about this organism. It is a unicellular and it has got a kinetoplast from where the flagella will arise. And then it is the one which resides in the blood. That is its habitat. That's why it is called as what? Hemoflagellate, right? And it has got a very peculiar thing that is called as undulating membrane. This is what you have to remember about the cruzi, how it looks. And very important is, what is the thing over here? Where is the kinetoplast present? It is at the terminal, that is near the tip of this organism. And what is the size? It is big. So the terminal kinetoplast, this is a very, very important. Because if you again remember my previous class, in the Trypanosoma brucei complex, which is responsible for African sleeping sickness, both of these organisms, they look almost all similar. But we need to identify them microscopically, right? There, the kinetoplast is small and it is subterminal. That is, it is present little bit below the tip. That's it. Now, why it is called as Chagas disease? What is the reason? Look at the person over here. So he is called Chagas. So he was the one who has accidentally discovered this trypanosoma in the intestine of which one, students? Redwood bug, right? So look at the bug over here. So this is what? It is an arthropod or the insect, right? So this is the insect. So when he was actually Chagas, no? He was the one who was appointed by this Cruz. He was his mentor. So now he was appointed in Brazil to work over the malaria. So there was some anti-malarial program that was going on somewhere in the year 1905. And especially near some rural area of this particular Brazil, where the railway tracks were laying down. So in that particular area, when he was working on malaria, suddenly he found that there is some bug, and that bug is sucking the blood of the people over there. And later what happened, those people used to fall sick. So now this Chagas suddenly felt, what is this bug and all, and why people are feeling sick? And suddenly people started complaining that there is chest compression and difficulty in breathing, and there is dysphagia also. Like he was like thinking, like, what happened? I came here to work on malaria and suddenly I started finding some other problem. So, like, then what happened? Slowly, his focus shifted from malarial program towards he started totally investigating on this particular new what symptoms. So later, ultimately, he has found this bug. Look at this bug over here. So now I want you people to observe this picture clearly, because nowadays most of the questions are MCQs or picture based. Look at this bug. Look at its tip over here. Yes. So look at the color over its body. Yes. So now it has got a big head, a conical shaped head, and neck is there, and thorax or the abdomen, all these parts it has got. Now in this bug, especially in its intestinal area, he has discovered this flagellated unicellular organisms, and he named them as what? Trypanosoma. Since his teacher or the mentor was who? Cruz. So look at the picture. So he was the Cruz. He was the mentor of Chagas. So in due respect of his mentor, he has named this Trypanosoma as Trypanosoma cruzi, right? And in respect to this particular Chagas, later the American government has named this particular disease as what? Chagas disease. And one question I want to ask you all students, what is the other name for this Chagas disease? What is the another name? Sneha, Yadgiri, Sirisha, Suchet, Shruti, Sakshi, anybody? Yeah, that is fine. American sleeping sickness, whatever is there. But remember here, students, this trypanosoma, it has got cruzi, it has allows to get into different organs, especially the muscles. So it getting goes to the heart and causes enlarges the heart. It goes to which one? GI tract, it enlarges the esophagus, it enlarges the colon. So what is the thing over here happening over here? It is trying to enlarge all the organs. So what the organs are happening? So if at all this is the esophagus, normally it is like this. This the moment it enters, it will become very huge. So we call it as what? Mega. That is mega. Mega means what? A very bigger version. So normally it looks like this. Now after getting infected with this particular cruzi, then what happens? Every organ becomes mega big and big. So that's why we call it as what? Mega disease. This point you have to remember. So these are all the different synonyms for one particular disease, Chagas disease. Now what is the vector for this redwood bug? It is also called as what? Kissing bug. Why it is called as kissing bug? Because the bite, whenever it sucks the blood, no, like it will be a painless bite, or the bite itself will be less painful. That's why we call it as what? Kissing bug. So the moment it tries to suck the blood of the host, so that biting phenomenon itself is less painful. Next, very important is that look at the map over here. So all these red areas, it indicates what? So these are the areas which are like endemic for this Chagas disease or American sleeping sickness. Yes, or it is also called as what? MD. That is mega disease. These points you need to remember over here. So where all we can see this particular disease? Central America. Can you all observe this? Central America, South America, and some part in the European areas. And Japan is also endemic to this, some areas of the Japan and even the Australia. So geographically, as a community point of view, we need to know where all this particular disease is prevalent. And why it is prevalent over here? Because the bug is over here. Which bug, students? What is the name of the bug? Yeah, redwood bug or the kissing bug. So it is also called as triatome bug. That is one more name for that. And another name for that bug is what? Vampire. Vampire bug. Why it is called as vampire bug? Because it always sucks the blood. So that's why it is also called as what? Vampire bug. So these are all the different names for one particular disease. And remember that in most of the cases, nearly 30% of the cases, cardiac changes are very much evident. In 10% of the cases, digestive and neurological changes are prominent. So these points you need to remember. Right? Next. Now let us see very important things over here related to Trypanosoma life cycle. So it has got two morphological forms in the humans, and it exists in another two different morphological forms in the vector, that is in the bug, redwood bug. It's also called as what? Kissing bug. It is also called as what? Vampire bug. So what are those two different morphological structures it exists? So in the man, it exists in amastigote form. Another is tripomastigote. So look at this rounded green color picture over here. Can you all see this? It is a amastigote form. A means what? Nahi. That is no. It doesn't contain. And mastigote means what? What is the meaning of this? All these organisms, no, they belong to mastigophora. So mastigo means what? It is nothing but the flagella. So these are the ones which doesn't contain any flagella. Now, where are these amastigotes? They are present. They are present intracellularly, especially in the macrophages of the reticuloendothelial system. Remember this. They are present where, students? It is present in the macrophages. Now, when they are present within the macrophages, so now these long, thin, slender, flagellated structures, when they enter the macrophages by the process of engulfation, so what happens? They create the vacuoles, and within the vacuoles, inside the macrophages, they start multiplying and they become rounded things. That means what? The flagella is totally absent. Now, only one work they have. Now, I don't want any food. I am nicely protected within the cell, and now they start only replicating by means of what? Binary fission. So that particular form of this Trypanosoma cruzi within the cell, we call it as what? Amastigotes. Now what happens once the macrophages, they are fully loaded with this what? Amastigotes. Then what happens? Then slowly they again convert into thin, long, slender forms within the macrophages. Now macrophages cannot accommodate such a huge number of parasites within it. So one stage will come where the macrophages will bust. It will, what will happen? The macrophages will bust or break open, and all these thin forms will come out and they will enter into the circulation. And then again, if they are caught up by one more new macrophage, again they will enter the macrophage. The moment they enter, they convert into what? No flagellated or aflagellated forms, which are called as what? Amastigote forms. Right? Another form in the man, that is tripomastigotes, they are usually present outside the cell. And again, they exist in two different forms over here. One is long and thin, another is short and stumpy form. So it may exist in long and thin version, or this fellow, he may be short and he may be plump, or the fatty fellow also. So two different forms are there. Now what happens, the redwood bug, when it comes and sucks the blood of the infected man, now what will happen? The short stumpy form will enter the vector, which we call it as what? Epimastigote form. This short stumpy form, we call it as what? Epimastigote form. Now in the bug, what happens within its intestine, especially in its most distal or the hind region, it will convert into another form that is called as metacyclic tripomastigote. And this is the infective form to the man. Very important MCQ question. You all have to remember this. Yes, are you all clear, students? So which is the infective form to the man? That is the metacyclic tripomastigote. So that is the infective form to the man. You have to remember this. So the same thing, just this slide is representing here. So how many morphological forms are there in man? Students, how many forms are there?
Serisha,
there are two forms. One is amastigote, that is they look round or oval. Look at this picture over here. They look round, oval, without the flagella. Now flagella is not there means what? Flagella is the organ of locomotion. So another description what you can give, it is non-motile. But very important is they keep on multiplying. So look at the microscopic picture over here. So what are all these dot dot things? So they are nothing but the amastigotes, which are present within the macrophages of the host or the man. And they resemble the Leishmanial form. So when in the next class, when I take Leishmaniasis, so there I will describe what are these LD bodies and all. So they exactly what resemble the Leishmanial intracellular form. So therefore, they are also called as what? Leishmanial form. And what all structures it contains? So it basically contains, this is a nucleus. Just look at the picture over here, nucleus. And then it contains kinetoplast. So what is this kinetoplast? In the last class itself, I told you, it is nothing but a group of mitochondrial DNA, remember. And from where the flagella usually arises. So what all things it contains prominently? One is nucleus, another is kinetoplast. They are round and they are multiplying. They keep on dividing by which method, students? By means of binary fission. This point you have to remember. Then the next form is trypomastigote. So like once the macrophages are loaded with this, it will bust, and this trypomastigote, it will come out. Look at this trypomastigote. How does it look? Look at the shape over here. It looks which shape? Either C shape, or it may look U shape, or it may look S shape. So this is a peculiar description of this particular trypomastigote. It may exist either as thin and long, or it may be short and stumpy. Very, very important, students. Very important MCQ question, that is, it is non-multiplying. It never multiplies. And where it is seen? It is seen in the peripheral blood. And what does it contain? Where is the flagella over here? Can you identify the flagella in this picture, students? Am I audible to everyone? Sirisha, Suchet, Yadgiri, others, Sakshi?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm in the third picture. Yeah.
Yeah. So now, can you see the most distal or the proximal portion, a thin, slender structure over here? This is a flagella. So flagella is present means what? It is a free swimming fellow. So this particular organism, it swims within the blood. So it loves to swim, but it never multiplies. And why it swims? Because it has to search for the food, and it is swimming in such a way that it has to find some organ where it can lodge over there, and where it can turn. And it can again start dividing in the form of mastigotes, right? So now let us look at this microscopic picture. So microscopically, look at this, because a very important thing. So this is a flagella. Now what is this particular structure? In the beginning itself, I told you, this is undulating membrane. This should be there always in your mind. Why I'm telling you this particular thing? Because in Leishmania, because that fellow also belongs to the same hemoflagellate only, but that Leishmania doesn't contain this undulating membrane. This is one of the difference you need to remember. And what is this particular thing? It is a kinetoplast, right? And in the center, what you can see over here? It is a nucleus. Now, look at this another microscopic picture where you can see Bruzy and Cruzy. Cruzy is responsible for what? C for Cruzy. C is responsible for what? Chagas disease, right? Now, Now, like, let us try to differentiate between these two. If at all a microscopic picture is given for you, how do we differentiate? Now, look at this very small, a dot-like thing that we call it as what? Kinetoplast. Whereas in Cruzy, you see, compare the size. So it is very bigger in size, right? So from here, this particular flagella will arise. So whenever you see a bigger kinetoplast, and look at the shape of this trypomastigote, what is the shape? Can you appreciate the C shape over here? Something like this, C or U or S shape. So that shape is very much evident over here. But whereas in Bruzy, which causes African, it has got some irregular shape over here. So these points you need to remember. And another important point, look at the picture over here, the microscopic picture. Here the organism is what? Dividing over here. Whereas in Cruzy, no such peripheral division can be seen in the blood. So these points you need to clearly appreciate over here, right? Next. Now let us see in the redweed bug. So redweed bug, what all forms can be seen here? One is epimastigote form. So look at this bug. Especially in the middle region of its intestine, this particular little bit long, slender forms can be seen, and they keep on multiplying. So this point you have to remember. Now, when it reaches the hind gut, that is the distal or the back portion of its gut area, so you see furthermore thing, and it has got a very long flagella. So metacyclic trypomastigotes, what is the structure over there? So if you see the structure, the size or the length of the flagella is much bigger than that of the length of their body. So that is very important. And this particular thing is what? Non-dividing, and they are excreted in the fecus, and they are infected to what? Man. So one of the very important MCQ question. Now, what is the extrinsic incubation period? That means what? In this bug, how many days does it take to convert from epimastigote to metacyclic trypomastigotes? Nearly 8 to 10 days it will take, right? Do you all agree with this? Fine. Now let us see some important points about this bug. So this bug is what? It is a hematophagous bug. What do you mean by hematophagous? What is the meaning of this hematophagous?
Feeds on blood.
Yeah, it always feeds on the blood. So that is the meaning of this particular bug. So it is a hematophagous and it is a egg-laying bug. Because in the last class I had described about which one, CC fly, does it lay the eggs or it does not lay the eggs? There is no egg. It directly gives birth to the younger one, that is the larvae. Whereas this particular redweed bug, it gives lays the eggs. And what is the size of this particular bug? It is a little bit longer in size, nearly 3 to 4 centimeters long it is. And the adults, they have got the wings. And it is somewhat orange to brown in color. Very important is that if the house is constructed of the mud, see these mud houses, no, this particular organism, it lives over there. So mud filled walls or the mud constructed house or very bad constructed or the house with the cracks. So these are all the areas where it lives. And very important is that near the house, if at all there is a rat burrow, if the rat hole is there, and make sure that it even lives in the rat holes or the rat burrows. So make sure that all these things should be educated to the public, like a good house construction or the home hygiene, everything should be maintained. If at all house is made up of mud, any cracks are there, make sure that all those cracks should be sealed. If a rat burrow is there, make sure that the rat burrow should be totally taken away so that these organisms, they won't reside over there. Very important is that even though it bites, but the infection is transmitted because of the fecus. Remember this, very important. And very important thing is that this bug, it always hides in the daytime. And in the nighttime, due to the, like, it has got a lot of attraction towards which one? Carbon dioxide. So as a man sleeps, so when he respires, what happens? There will be a lot of carbon dioxide content in the area. Now when there is no good ventilation, so like there is some chemo attraction will be there, especially towards the carbon dioxide. So now carbon dioxide, ammonia, all these are what? Attractants for this particular bug. So in the night time, the bug, in response to this carbon dioxide, ammonia, it will get attracted towards the host or the site and it will what? Suck the blood. And it nearly takes 10 to 20 minutes to fill its stomach. 10 to 20 minutes to fill its stomach. And while sucking the blood, what will happen? It will defecate also. It will defecate. Now remember, while sucking the Trypanosoma cruzi is not transmitted. It is transmitted because of the defecation. Now once it bites, and along simultaneously along with the bite, what will happen? It will defecate also. Now during this defecation, what will happen? The metacyclic trypomastigotes are thrown out in that fecus. Now after that, the organism will leave the host. Now what will happen? The man, he will feel something has bitten me and he will try to scratch over there. Now what will happen? The fecal matter, whatever is present over here, it will get into this area of scratch or the site of cut on the skin area. Now slowly the trypomastigotes that are present in the fecal matter, it will enter into the host vascular system and slowly it will reach its site or the organs wherever it has to reach, especially the reticuloendothelial system, right? Now students, I want to tell you a very important thing over here from community medicine point of view. Now you all know that this organism is very much active in the night time, right? Now, if you want to run away this organism, what is the public health measure we have to do? Sirisha, Suchet and others, what measure we need to take over here? Sneha, Yadgiri. Now, look at the phenomenon over here. See, night time, it is very much like attraction is there. Now, what can be done to just make this bug away from our house? Put a light over there.
Bed net. Yeah?
Tell me. Somebody told answer. Yes. What can we do, students? Thing is that as a public health people,
repellents.
We need to put a yellow color light. Yellow color light. So what happens, like when we give the health education to the people, especially in these endemic areas, go and tell them, use a mosquito net or you always switch on one yellow color bulb over there. So what happens, because of that light color itself, this organism, this insect won't reach that area. This one thing we can do, or ask them to put a lamp over there, at least kerosene lamp or anything yellow in color, because daylight it will be usually yellowish in color. So yellow color is something like that makes this bug away from that area. So whenever you give a health education, especially in these what chagas endemic areas, you need to specify that, make sure that a yellow color should be placed inside the room, right? Next. Now let us see a few points about this bug. So like how many pairs of legs it has got? Look at the picture over here. How many pairs of legs it has got?
Three pairs.
That is very, very good. So that is totally six legs or three pairs, we can say. Fine. And it has got two antenna are present. And whenever it bites, no, that time, a long proboscis will come out. That is a mouth organ, that is sucking organ. So that is one of the speciality of this ruvid bugs. And this particular ruvid bug, no, it is called as bold organism or the bold bug, B-O-L-D. So remember why it is called as bold bug, because no, like in the early 15th century and even Charles Darwin, so in his book, and in 15th century, one of the priests also, he has mentioned that like what happened, this bug, they have caught it, and then so many people were surrounding. Now this bug was not at all scared, actually. It was like, okay, let so many people be there, I'm least bothered. And what happened, this particular bug, what it has done, it went, even though many people are there, it has nicely thrown out its proboscis and it has sucked the blood around, so it has fed itself and it has left the area. So now looking at this particular nature of the bug, what they have termed it as, it is also called as what? Bold bug. Remember this name. So till now, what all the different names or synonyms we have learned for this redweed bug? It is also called as kissing bug.
Vampire.
It is also called as triton bug. It is also called as what?
Vampire bug.
Excellent answer. Vampire bug. Then it is also called as what? Bold bug. So these all are the different names for this one particular bug. And it usually bites in the areas which are uncovered by the body parts, especially around the mouth. This is very, very important. So if the man is there and if he is sleeping, then what happens? This bug, which is its favorite area to bite, especially around the mouth. That's why it is called as what? Kissing bug, because around the mouth it bites, and even though the moment it bites, it doesn't feel like, we don't feel as if it is biting. Yes? And why we don't feel any sensation of bite over there? Why, students? Because it has got some salivary proteins, which has got, which are especially something like neurotoxin, some anesthetic effect is there. And it even has got anti-clotting effect. So the saliva of this bug, no, when it tries to bite, so it releases some proteins over there, so which has got anesthetic effect and even anti-clotting effect. And when it bites, especially around the mouth, it is called as what? Kissing bug. And very important is that sometimes the moment the bug bites, the individual may develop hypersensitivity reaction. Especially what? It may land up into which one? Anaphylactic reaction, that is type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. So the moment bug bites, the patient will suddenly feel something has happened to me. So within no time, the patient will land up into anaphylaxis. So such chances are also there. So that means what? This bug is a very, very dangerous bug. So thing is that the effect may land up into directly Chagas disease, or immediately the patient may land up into hypersensitivity reaction. And one more thing about this bug is that it is hemimetabolous. What do you mean by like hemimetabolous? It is also one of the description for this bug. That means these are the types of bugs or the arthropods which live both in land and water. These points you have to remember. And look at this picture. What is this picture it is representing? Students, what is it?
Eggs.
Excellent. So eggs, how can you describe over here? Look at this. All these eggs are like what? Adherent to each other. So that means what? They are sticky to each other. So looking at this egg itself, you have to identify. So wherever the wall surface, leaf surface, or any surface is there, this bug, the female bug, it lay the eggs, and all these eggs, they are not independent. They are always what? Sticky to each other. So this is one of the nature of the eggs, and these eggs, no, they vary in color. So they vary in brown, light brown, dark brown, and ultimately that particular egg color, what it will be white in color. So before the larvae that comes out from that egg, that color of that egg, what will be the color? White in color. Now students, look at this different poly like different chromogenic colors. Can you see here? One egg is in dark brown, one is light yellow, light brown, and some are totally white in color. Can you all appreciate the color over here, students?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Welcome, Roshan. Hello, Roshan.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, nice to see you again here. So yeah, now, yeah. Students, one important announcement I want to tell you here. On board right now, Dr. Roshan is here. So he was the foundation, first student of our MedPG, and he has done his MBBS from Bangladesh. Roshan?
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
And Roshan has cleared his FMG yesterday night. The results has come, and very excellent performance by our very favorite student. He was our starting student. So we are very, very happy to announce that he has cleared, and the passing percentage was itself 9%. And in that he has cleared, and he has cracked more than 50%. So it's an excellent achievement from our beloved student, Dr. Roshan. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very happy to see you over here. Anything you want to tell to our students, Sakshi and others? Sirisha? Okay. Fine. I'll continue with the class.
Yes, ma'am. Can continue.
So I want to congratulate Roshan on behalf of our MedPG team. And I wish everyone also, all others who are attending our classes, a huge and very happy success for everybody in future also. Whatever the exams, maybe theory or clinicals or entrance exams, everything should be successful for everyone, right? Fine.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Now, this redwood exists in three forms. What are those three forms? Egg, the adult one, it will lay the eggs. After copulation, then from the egg, what will come? The larval form, which is called as nymph. And this nymph, it will later again convert into adult form. And remember, students, all this, whether it is nymph or adult, they have only one thing, that is sucking the blood. Sucking the blood. This point you have to remember over here. So always, whether it is larvae or adult, they always try to suck the blood for their own development, growth and development. And especially the nymph, the larva, it exists in five stages. And especially the last two stages of the larvae, that is the fourth and fifth stages, they feed a lot on the blood. And another thing you have to remember, the differentiation between the adult male and female. So adult females, once they get converted into adults, so the females, if you see, they are larger than the males. And the especially the posterior end or the tip of the female, it is pointed. It is pointed. Whereas the male, how does the posterior end it will be? It is somewhat rounded. So if you see this rounded tip, I mean the rounded back or the abdominal area, so you can say it is male. Yes, if it is female, it will be how it will be? It will be pointed. And how many pairs of legs will be there? Three pairs of legs. And it will be having what? The brownish orange color, especially on its wings area. And if you closely look at its hind legs or the back legs, what you can see, the spines will be present. So this point you have to remember. And very important thing over here is that there is no trans-ovarial transmission. What do you mean by trans-ovarial transmission? What do you mean by this? So that means what? If this bug gets infected, so it won't transmit this Trypanosoma cruzi to its egg. So the next generation, it won't get infected. But there are some organisms, or they arthropods, if they get infected, it will just transmit those parasites from one generation to another generation. So this is very important thing. So there is no trans-ovarial transmission. So if this one generation is infected with the Trypanosoma cruzi, it ends in that particular generation itself, right? And which is the most common season for these bugs to be seen? It is most commonly seen during the period of May and June. July. So during this particular season, we need to take extra care. So whenever we give a health education to the people in that endemic area, we need to tell them that during this particular season, take the utmost precautions. Then one more thing I want to tell you that whenever there is a lot of wind is there, this particular organism, it cannot fly. So what is the thing that stops this organism from, or the arthropod from moving from one place to another place? That is the wind. This point you have to remember. Next, what are the various modes of transmission for this Chagas disease? So very important is that, especially because of the bite of this redweed bug, and especially it is not the bite or the saliva that is causing, it is a fecal matter. So when it bites, what happens? It will suck the blood, but simultaneously it will defecate also. So this point of defecation, what does it contains? Metacyclic trypomastigotes. So this is the fecal matter which contains this organism, and it will enter the human. And what is the other mode of transmission? Food contamination. So that is one more possible thing. Then what is another mode? Already from an infected person, when we do the blood transfusion, so that is also one of the chance from where the Chagas transmission can happen. So what we need to do over here, what is important? Blood screening is very important. So we need to always screen the blood, especially in the endemic areas. So this point you need to remember. Then during organ transplantation, then there is vertical transmission. What do you mean by vertical transmission?
From mother to spread to baby. Mother to baby.
What do you mean by vertical transmission? Mother to fetus.
To placenta.
Mother to fetus. Yeah, very good. So that we call it as what? Congenital Chagas disease. Now, very important is carriers or the reservoirs. Like apart from the this redweed bug, so like we should be careful with these organisms. Like cat can be there, cat. Then there may be some opossums. So these are all the different organisms. Like a dog can be there, rabbit can be there, and sometimes rat can be there, and this one armadillo. So these are all the different domestic, peri-domestic, and wild animals. So these all organisms, this Trypanosoma cruzi will be present, or it can be present. But the thing is that they multiply and all, but they don't show any clinical symptoms for these organisms, right? Do you all agree? So we need to be careful whenever we try to play with the cat or dog or the monkey, all these organisms, don't directly show your affection over there. Maybe that this fellow may be just nicely residing in these organisms. All right? Next. Nowadays, they can give a life cycle of this organism and they can ask you actually. So just a brush up over here. So now you people only describe it over here. Anyone want to describe the life cycle over here? Sirisha or Suchet or anybody? Yadgiri, Sneha, Sakshi, Shruti, anyone? Redweed bug is there. Bug, it has defecated while biting. Now the fecal matter, what is present, students? Metacyclic trypomastigote. Why I am stressing? Because it's an MCQ question. It will enter the human skin, and it will enter into the host blood circulatory system. Then it will be caught up by which one? Macrophages. And look at in the macrophages, this long slender form metacyclic trypomastigotes are converted into round oval structures, which are called as what? Amastigotes. Now what will happen? They start dividing. They start dividing by means of which one? Binary fission. Now when the macrophages is fully loaded, what will happen? Now, after amastigotes, they will again convert into trypomastigotes. There will be what? Cell lysis or busting of the cell. Again, this thin slender forms, it will come out, and again it will enter the circulatory system. And now if the bug, it will come, if it sucks the blood, then again it will get into the bug. And in the bug, again, it will undergo epimastigote and metacyclic tripomastigotes, and again when the bug bites, the same cycle will be repeated. This is what you have to remember. Any doubts here, students? Shall I continue further? Shall I? Now let us see the clinical features. Now here it is very, very important for us. Look at the picture over here. In the beginning itself, I told you, it enlarges all the organs. If the esophagus is this much, it will make it very big. Colon is this much, it will make it very, very big colon. So heart is, if it is only this much heart, then what it will do? It will just enlarge the heart, that is dilatation of the heart. So that's why we call it as what? Mega disease. Now look at this picture. Such a huge colon or the intestinal structures are there. Huge, huge things. So clinically, these presentations are very important. So it can be presented in acute Chagas, intermediate stage, chronic Chagas disease. And symptomatic are which one, students? Now you should only tell. Symptomatic are acute and chronic. These two are the symptomatic clinical stages of this Chagas. And whereas this intermediate Chagas is what? It is asymptomatic. It is asymptomatic. This point you have to remember. So after acute, the person will enter into intermediate stage. Then after some years, he will enter into chronic. So after acute, if you feel that all symptoms are over, now again you feel that person has recovered, that is not the thing you need to neglect over there. No. He has entered into which stage, students? Asymptomatic intermediate stage. This point you have to remember. Now let us see the clinical manifestations in detail. So the moment the bug bites, what will happen, students? What did I tell you? The moment the bug bites, what will happen? Immediate reaction, what it can be? There can be hypersensitivity reaction. That hypersensitivity reaction may be mild, or it may maybe like in a very severe form, landing up into anaphylaxis, right? Or type 1 hypersensitivity. Now, if this thing is overcome, then the person, he may manifest a peculiar skin lesion at the site of bite. So that we call it as what? Chagoma. It is what? Chagoma means oma. You can see, no? Like oma means a tumor-like. It is a tumor-like. So some enlarged cutaneous lesion at the site of bite, and it is an inflammatory. It is an inflammatory. And it is a painful lesion because this particular ridweed bug, the moment it bites, its salivary proteins, it contains so many toxic things within its saliva. So in response to this toxic things, inflammatory reaction will happen and pain, it will be there. So it is a painful inflammatory cutaneous and swollen reaction, which we call it as what? Chagoma. It is seen at the site of bite. Right? Do you all agree with this? And along with this chagoma, what will happen? There will be regional or local lymph adenopathy. This point is very, very important. And within how many days you can see immediately after the bite, or within few weeks you can see this acute Chagas lesions. And this itself is a self-limiting lesion, and it may get healed by within a few days or few weeks. And it may be like associated with diarrhea and vomiting if at all there is a gastrointestinal tract involvement. These points you have to remember. So the MCQ it can be asked is, what is chagoma? What is chagoma, sir, students? Remember, chagoma, everything, it is a C factor over here. It is caused by Trypanosoma cruzi. And another C stands for what?
Chagas.
Yeah, Chagas disease. And it is a cutaneous lesion at the site of bite, right? And it is Chagas disease, as you said. Fine. Do you all agree with this? So triple C is for this chagoma. Remember this. Next, very important thing is that Romanus sign. It is very important. It is also what? At the site of bite. The point where it bites and where the inoculation of this metacyclic tripomastigotes happens, especially in the eye area. So it is nothing but Romanus sign is what, Sirisha? What is that sign?
Swelling of the...
Excellent. Yeah. So it is nothing but unilateral. Look at the eyes. If the bug has come and bitten over here near the eye region, what will happen at that site, especially in that eye area? So unilateral painless edema of the periocular tissue. So if at all, whenever the bug, it will bites in the conjunctival area. So when conjunctiva is a portal of entry and painless edema of the periocular tissue is seen, then we call it as what? Romanus sign. So it is also one of the pathognomic feature of what? Pathognomic feature of acute Chagas. And once after this inflammatory edematous lesion, it will be followed by what? High fever. The patient will complain of what? I have got a high fever. Then there will be generalized lymphadenopathy. This point you have to remember. In the initial stages, what happened? There was a local or regional lymphadenopathy. Later, what happened? There will be generalized lymphadenopathy. And if it enters into spleen and liver, what will happen? They will also become big and big. So bigger and bigger. So that time what will happen? There will be hepatosplenomegaly. This point you have to remember. Then all these features, they will resolve by themselves within 4 to 8 weeks. And later it will enter into next stage, that is called as intermediate stage, followed by it will slowly enter into chronic phase, right? And in the acute phase, the death may happen. It is not very common. If at all a death can happen, means it may be because of the cardiac involvement. There will be severe myocarditis, where especially there will be conduction defects. And ultimately, it will result in what? Heart failure. But all this complication is a rare in case of acute Chagas. So what is the cause for death in case of acute Chagas, students? What might be the possible reason for death in acute Chagas?
Myocarditis.
Heart failure.
Yeah, and if at all, if it involves the neurological system or CNS, then meningoencephalitis. So especially if the child is lesser than 2 years, very small baby, less than 2 years, if the child is infected with this Trypanosoma cruzi, and if at all there is a neurological involvement, then the baby may present with which one? Meningoencephalitis, that is the layers of the brain and even the tissue of the brain, both are totally inflamed by this Trypanosoma cruzi. So, and all those meningoencephalitis features will be seen. And it is also one of the complication, right? So acute Chagas disease, it is more commonly seen in whom children? Students. It is commonly seen in children. So acute Chagas disease, what all points you want to highlight over here? It is very much common in children and it lasts for 1 to 4 months. What are its pathognomic clinical features? One is Chagoma. That is a Chagoma. Second one is Romanus sign, because it was first described that person. Then after that, after this site of bite, all these inflammatory features are over, then it will be followed by high grade fever. Then there will be generalized lymphadenopathy. Then there will be organ enlargement, especially hepatosplenomegaly. Then what are the possible complications landing up in death? That is myocarditis and meningoencephalitis. Fine. Now, after this, what is the next stage it will land up into clinically? Intermediate stage. Remember, here the patient will be absolutely asymptomatic. This point is very important. And he may remain asymptomatic for many years. And he will act as a carriers for others also, because asymptomatic, we feel that he is totally fine and he may give the blood to others, or the bug may come and bite him and bug gets infected and that bug will go and bite the healthy person. So these people are very, very what? Dangerous people. So we need to identify these people, and it may progress later into which one? Chronic stage. Yes. And sometimes this intermediate stage, it may not progress to chronic stage, provided that the virulence is low. This point you have to remember. And why it is asymptomatic? Because the organism, it usually resides in the intracellular location, especially in the macrophages. And what happens? Because of that, it will escape the immune response. And there will be also plasticity of the parasite, because this parasite keeps changing its form from the round mastigote form to thin, long, slender forms, that is tripomastigotes. That is the flagellated forms. So like it keeps on changing its form. So that is the reason our immune system will find it difficult to show any good response to this. So that is the reason in this intermediate stage, usually the individual will be asymptomatic. Next. After passing on this intermediate stage, the person will enter into what? Chronic Chagas disease. Very, very important. So in chronic Chagas disease, what will happen? After a period of 10 to 20 years or even 40 years, what will happen? After the initial bite from the Ruttweed bug, that is after acute phase, after so many years, he will present the clinical symptoms. Now here, heart and the GIT, that is cardiac and GIT, these are the very, very important manifestations of this chronic Chagas disease. And who are like very much prone for this? Adults and older children. These are the ones where 30% of the chronic Chagas disease can be seen over here. So which are the two organs like commonly affected in chronic Chagas? One is heart, another is GI system. And what is the important thing is that the inflammatory response in this chronic stage, it will result in cellular destruction. And ultimately this result in fibrosis of the muscles and nerves, and which control the heart and esophagus and the colon. So now what will happen when the neurological tissue that itself has been destroyed? Now there is no control or signal for anything. So all this will be lost. Now what will happen? The organ, it will keep on enlarging because it doesn't have any signals when to contract, when to relax, when to do what, because the nervous tissue itself is damaged and it has undergone total destruction. So now organ will happen what? It will undergo its enlargement because there is no neurological transmission or signals are happening over here. Now in the heart, what can be seen? There will be dilated cardiomyopathy, that is heart will enlarge, especially the ventricles, right? And then what will happen? Very important. This is a very important MCQ question. What can happen in chronic Chagas? There will be rhythm disturbances, especially right bundle branch block. So this point you have to remember. The right bundle branch block will happen. So there will be what? Rhythm disturbances will happen. This is one of the classic things. And that is the reason in chronic Chagas, what is recommended? ECG and other cardiac investigations are recommended, right? Then apart from that, there will be thromboembolism. So these are all the different cardiac manifestations you have to mention. So whenever you mention what things you mention in cardiac manifestation in chronic Chagas, dilated cardiomyopathy and rhythm disturbances, especially right bundle branch. Next, whenever there is a chronic Chagas, if at all GI system, that is gastrointestinal tract, is infected, then what manifestation can be seen? Sakshi, Yadgiri, others, what can be seen?
Dilated colon.
Yeah, dilated esophagus. Dilated colon. Yeah, that we call it as what? Mega esophagus, mega colon. Why it happens? Again, I told you, for any of this esophagus or colon, sympathetic and parasympathetic. So there should be what? A controlled coordination between these two systems. So when these two system itself is destructed by trypanosoma cruzi, so the muscle tone will be lost and they keep on enlarging to the maximum extent. So that results in what? That results in mega esophagus. So whenever there is an enlarged esophagus, what will be the patient complaints? The patient will complain of dysphagia, that is difficult in swallowing. Then there will be chest pain because of compression, and there will be regurgitation of the gastric contents. And sometimes because of this regurgitation, there can be aspiration pneumonia. And sometimes this itself will land up into what? Death. So these are all the different clinical presentation whenever there is a mega esophagus, right? And whenever there is a mega colon, look at the colon, how big it has become. So when the colon has itself has enlarged and become big, then what will happen? There will be abdominal pain and there will be chronic constipation. And this chronic constipation will result in what? Accumulation of the fecal matter in the colon, which we call it as what? Fecaloma, which we call it as what? Fecaloma. This is a very, very important clinical or the investigative picture of this. Which one? Chronic Chagas disease.
Yeah.
So what is the difference between a normal constipation and the constipation of this Chagas disease? Anybody? Suchet, Yadgiri, or Sneha, Shivani, Sirisha, Sakshi? So how can we distinguish from over there? See, now, can you all hear me, students?
Yes, ma'am.
am I audible? Yeah. Now what yeah. happens is, like, if it is a routine constipation due to some dehydration or some reasons, what happens? So there the patient will feel like defecating, that urge will be there, but he can't defecate, he or she. But here what happens in Chagas disease, that urge or feel to defecate itself is not there, because all that stretch reflexes, everything is lost because of the destruction. All those receptors, stretch reflexes, everything is gone, and that urge to defecate itself is lost. So you take the history from the patient. Do you feel like defecating, that senses you have? Then the patient will say, mujhe kabhi nahi lagta hai. So that itself should strike to your mind that the stretch reflexes are lost. That means the neurological destruction has taken place, and it might be possible case of what? Chronic Chagas disease. So then try to think of this fecaloma. So remember this point. Yes? So what are the things that we can see in the chronic Chagas disease students? Megaesophagus, megacolon, and cardiomyopathy. So these are the three classic presentation of this chronic Chagas disease. MMC, that is megaesophagus, megacolon, and cardiomyopathy. Now, what is the possible mechanism or pathogenesis? What they have, some people they have implicated is that there may be some autoantibodies that are produced against this trypanosoma, like some autoantibodies, and there will be cross reactivity also that can happen, and this cross reactivity leads to the destruction of endocardium and vascular structures, and even the structures of the neural tissue, that is Schwann's sheet of the somatic and autonomic nerves of the peripheral nervous system. So this is one of the possible pathogenic or pathogenesis mechanism. Next, just a second. Yeah, very important thing is about congenital Chagas disease. Now, all the till now we have seen about which one, students? Acute Chagas, intermediate Chagas, and chronic Chagas. Now, all these clinical features are over. Now, let us see something about congenital, because in South America, now this congenital Chagas cases are increasing in number. That means what? We should be careful. This prevalence has rates are increasing day by day. Now, that is from mother to baby, it is getting transmitted. Now, let us see some of the facts over here. 5% of the, if the mother is having chronic Chagas, then the chances of transmission from mother to child is 5%. And if at all the mother is HIV infected, and there is a reactivation of this Chagas disease, then the transmission from mother to babies or the fetus is how much? It is 100%. It is what? 100%. And if the mother is in acute phase, then the chance of transmission is nearly 50%. So these facts you need to remember. And one more, the latest information, what they have said is that the congenital Chagas, if you take out the Trypanosoma cruzi and genetically, if you try to study this organism, parasite, so there are 5 genetic variants of this Trypanosoma cruzi, that is Trypanosoma cruzi 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. If the mother is having this Trypanosoma cruzi 5, which is a genotype, so if at all the mother is harboring this genotype variant 5, then the transmission is what? 80 to 100%, pakka it is there. So these are the some of the advanced research that they have told. So when you take the amniotic fluid or the maternal samples, then if at all genotypic studies if you do, then if you see TC5, then the chances of transmission from mother to baby is how much? Very high it is. And the congenital transmission is also dependent on the amount of parasitemia in the mother. That is, if the parasite load is less in the mother, then less chance of transmission. If it is high, then it is high chances of transmission. So now from a community point of view, what things we have to remember? Students, just a second. Just a second. Yeah, can you all hear me?
Just a second.
Yes, ma'am. So now, from the community point of view, so there is something, this is what recommended by the WHO. So if at all we go to the endemic areas, that is in Central or South American areas, and if you find any pregnant lady, so what we have to do, we need to do the screening of the pregnant lady. So what is the algorithm for screening? So what we have to do, we need to screen the pregnant lady. So take the blood samples and look at over her. Like if we find her to be reactive, like if she is positive for the T. cruzi, then what we have to do, we need to give the treatment for her and we need to monitor her. And then if such a mother gives birth to the newborn, then again newborn also has to be tested for the parasite. But if she finds to be non-reactive, that is if she is found to be negative for Trypanosoma cruzi, don't worry. So nothing to bother over here, and discharge that mother. And then what we have to do, if the mother is positive, then what we have to do, give the appropriate treatment to the mother. And after she delivers the baby, then what we have to do, we need to check the baby also, the newborn. So you need to take a blood smear, and then you have to look for the organism. And if the baby finds to be positive, give the treatment and then monitor the baby. And if the baby is negative, then after 8 months, we need to do the serological test. So after 8 months, again, what happens if the serological test is also negative, then don't worry. So you discharge the baby is totally free. But after 8 months, then if the serological test finds to be reactive, then we need to give the treatment for the baby and try to monitor the baby. So why the serological test has to be done after 8 months, students? What is the reason for that? Anybody?
Development of immune system in the baby.
That is there, actually, that is fine. But another thing is that maternal antibodies will be present. So like maternal antibodies, like it itself may give a false positive results over there. So just to avoid that false positive results, let us wait till the maternal antibodies are decline, and we want to look out only for this parasitic antigens. So it is better is that we do the serological test after 8 months. That time it will be like more of true results will be obtained. So this particular what screening protocol has been given by whom? World Health Organization during its 63rd World Health Meeting or the Assembly, which was held in Geneva in the month of May 2010. So just remember, this particular screening protocol was given by whom? It was given by World Health Organization in the year 2010. This point you have to remember. And usually the molecular methods, that is PCR, polymerase chain reaction, usually we don't do it because they are very expensive, and such technological investments also difficult to do in like geographically or economically poor regions. But child, this is the only country in the world at presently the government mandates that PCR has to be done to get confirmatory results. What is the significance of doing this PCR is like no need to wait for 8 months. Just before that, in the newborn itself, do a PCR and you will get a very confirmatory results, right? Are you all clear with this protocol for the screening protocol for the pregnant lady?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now let us see some of the clinical manifestations of the CCD, that is congenital Chagas disease. So what is the percentage of congenital Chagas transmission? It is only 5 to 10%. If the baby is infected, its clinical manifestation may be mild or no signs. But if at all, if the baby is left untreated, what will happen as it grows into adult or as it becomes older? So the baby suddenly will manifest chronic Chagas if it is not treated properly. So the thing is that what the clinical manifestation of chronic Chagas? Myocarditis, that is heart involvement, and there will be GIT involvement. So these two will be the baby's presentation once it grows into adult. Now, the moment baby is born, what can be the immediate presentation if at all Chagas symptoms has to be seen, congenital Chagas? It may be low birth weight. So what is the ideal birth weight, students?
2500.
So 2.5 standards, it is this much. Oral, it is. So this is what is a regular thing which we norms we follow. But if it is anything lower than this, the baby, we call it as what? Low birth weight. And the baby may present with anemia. There may be thrombocytopenia, or there may be chances of intrauterine death, that is stillbirth will be there. And rarely the baby may present with myocarditis and some neurological manifestations. So these are the rare features. So congenital chagas, baby is born. So immediately what we can see, students, the baby will be having low birth weight, then anemia, thrombocytopenia, or rarely myocarditis and neurological alteration. If at all a severe chagas manifestation, means the baby will be showing CNS dysfunction, that is meningoencephalitis, there may be pneumonitis, and generalized edema will be there, that is anasarca. If it so severe that the baby may not survive and the baby may die, that is a death can happen. So congenital chagas, students, what all we have learnt over here, because very important, because nowadays they focus on this particular area. Like what is the, if the mother is HIV infected and she past history says that she is chagas positive, then her chances of transmitting this chagas to baby is 100%. This point has to be remembered. And which parasite genotype is very much virulent and chance of transmission, it is T. cruzi 5. So this variant is very much important. Next. What is the treatment over here, students? Treatment of congenital chagas. So if at all baby is identified as positive for congenital chagas, we need to treat the baby within 1 year. So within its infant stage itself, we need to treat it with which one? Nifurtimox or benznidazole. So these are the two most commonly used drugs for the treatment of the congenital chagas and even for the regular chagas, and both of them are effective, very good results are given, and cure rate is more than 90%. And if we leave it untreated, then the baby may get into which one? Chronic chagas disease. Now a little bit we'll see about the chagas and the HIV. If the person is HIV infected and there is a reactivation of the underlying Trypanosoma cruzi infection, then there will be what? Chance of meningoencephalitis, and it is one of the potential and the lethal complication of this chagas disease in case of HIV. So in a HIV patient, if the patient is found to be chagas positive, then what might be the possible complication? The most possible complication, what is it? Is it the heart involvement or the brain involvement? Which one, students?
Brain.
Yes.
Brain.
That is meningoencephalitis. So here almost all I'm done with the chagas disease. So just brush up, red wheat bug, bite. The moment it bites, what will happen? The fecal content will come. Metacyclic trypomastigotes will be there. It will enter the vascular system. And then later it will enter the macrophages, muscle tissue, and the nerve tissue. And in the macrophages, the thin long form, they get converted into rounded amastigote. A means what? Nahi, no. Mastigo means what? Flagella. So without flagella, they keep on dividing. And again, within the macrophage, they convert into thin long forms, cell lysis, they'll come out. And this is what it happens. Yes? Just a second. Just a second. How whiteboard hang to kono? How to get into what? W. Okay. Now certain points I want to inform you over here, students. Just a second. What is the culture media for this? Just let me write over here. What is the culture media? Can we grow this Trypanosoma cruzi in the culture media? Very important MCQ question. What is the culture media for Trypanosoma cruzi? That is triple N media. What is this triple N media stands for? First N, it stands for Novi. Then McNeil. This is very, very important. don't think that these are all like unwanted points. Very important because questions has been asked. Novi, McNeil, and Nicole. So triple N is the culture media to grow this particular T. cruzi, Trypanosoma cruzi. This point you have to remember. Like what we had to do, we need to take the blood sample, draw the blood, and we need to inoculate this particular culture media with this infected man's blood and incubate it at 22 to 24 degrees. And after 4 days, what will happen? We can see trypomastigotes or even epimastigotes. Trypomastigotes and even epimastigotes, they can be seen in this culture media. So what is the culture media to grow this Trypanosoma cruzi, students? What is the media? Triple N media. Students, are you all there? Sirisha, Suchin?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, triple N media. Now, one more very important thing I want to tell you. Like, we have drawn the blood. For example, an individual is there. And forgive my pictures. Like, we have needle, we have drawn the blood. Then what happens? We have prepared this slide. And under this slide, what happened? We have seen the Trypanosoma cruzi. Now, what is the motility of this Trypanosoma cruzi? What is the motility described? We call it as what? Snake. Remember this. Snake, saamke jaise move hota, snake-like motility. So how do we remember this? Like in the slide, like a snake, how it moves, like this, you know, these trypomastigotes, they keep on moving in this slide, that we can appreciate. Like Trypanosoma cruzi, it causes what? Enlarging the organs, causing what? Mega disease. Now, can you just correlate the enlarged colon or esophagus with a large python? Do you all correlate with that? A huge snake, python, how big it will be once its tummy is. So like a snake-like motility in Chagas disease, like a huge organ, and that organ contains this organism, and this organism under the microscope, it has got a snake-like motion. Very dangerous organism it is. So what is the description of the motility? Snake-like motility. Yes. Then very important thing is that, can we do any animal inoculation for this trypanosomiasis cruzi? Can we do animal inoculation? Yes, we can do. Like guinea pig, so animal inoculation can also be done to confirm the diagnosis for Trypanosoma cruzi. So in guinea pig, intraperitoneally, like mice inoculation is done with blood, CSF or the lymph node aspirate of the man, and intraperitoneally we just inoculate it. And then you wait for some days. Then again, you draw the blood from this mice and then put it under the slide. And then you look at for this trypomastigotes. And again, you can see some snake-like motility fashioned organisms confirming our diagnosis for Trypanosoma cruzi. Yes. So animal maybe hum inoculate kar sakte, and then we can confirm our diagnosis. Then what is a very, very important thing? Xenodiagnosis. Xeno, X-E-N-O. What do you mean by xenodiagnosis, students? Xeno means what? Foreign. So that means what? In some foreign creature, we just inject the blood and then we see whether the Trypanosoma cruzi is multiplying over there or no. That means what? The same Rudweed bug, uska nymph stage, that is the larval stage, Rudweed bug ka nymph stage, which is totally uninfected. So in the laboratory itself, we grow this redweed bug, and which is very healthy, not infected with the Trypanosoma cruzi. And when it reaches the nymph stage or the larval form, we will take the nymph and then we will ask this, make this nymph to feed the host, that is the man. So on whom we are like suspecting that he might be a Chagas case. So you take this nymph stage of the redweed bug and put it on the hand of this man, and this nymph will suck the blood and then take out the nymph, and then you just observe the nymph for some days, at least for how many weeks? 2 weeks. Then after 2 weeks, what happens? You aspirate the contents, intestinal contents of the nymph, and then if you see the Trypanosoma cruzi, the long elongated forms, then you can say that the person is infected with the T. cruzi. That means he is having what? Chagas disease. So what all diagnostic tests did we see here, students? So what all diagnostic tests we have done? So one is we can culture. Do the culture. What is the culture media? Triple N. Novi, McNeil and Nicole. This point you have to remember, triple N. If you don't remember these names also in question, in the AIIMS or any NEET pattern, if they say triple N media, it is for Trypanosoma cruzi, Chagas disease. And if they say that there is a snake-like motility of the organism in the peripheral blood smear, it is also for Trypanosoma cruzi. And animal inoculation, especially mice, and xenodiagnosis means, again, it is for Trypanosoma cruzi. That is in whom we are like doing this xenodiagnosis on same redweed bug only, that is kissing bug. Then what all other tests we can do? That is intradermal, another test, that is intradermal test. So intradermal, what will happen? We have got what? Cruzin antigen. So laboratory, we take the, this is the antigen which is obtained from the Trypanosoma cruzi. So like that antigen we take and intradermally we'll inject to the person, and then we'll look out for the reaction. So if there is any indurated intradermal reaction, then it is a confirmatory or positive for this Trypanosoma cruzi. Then even we can do molecular diagnosis, that is what PCR, polymerase chain reaction, can be done, which is nothing but a molecular diagnostic techniques. Then even what other diagnostic things we can do? Electrocardiograph, that is ECG. Why we are doing ECG over here? Because Trypanosoma cruzi, especially chronic, it has got more affinity to damage the heart. So like what in heart, what we can see, students? Dilated heart, and there will be what? Rhythm disturbances, especially conduction disturbances, especially right bundle branch block can be seen. Yeah. Then what else, what other investigations we can do, students? Endoscopy. Because we already know, right? Mega esophagus and all will be there, colonoscopy, endoscopy. These are all the things which we can suggest the patient to go ahead. Because once we are suspecting for what? Chagas disease. Yes, and other serological tests like ELISA, then indirect immunofluorescence. So all these are the different serological tests we can do it. So what all things we have seen here, students? Diagnostic test, or what are the laboratory diagnostic tests? First one?
Culture.
Which one? Yeah, culture. What is the culture media? Now you should only answer.
Triple N.
Triple N media. Okay. Or second thing, very important, before culture only, what we should do? Draw the blood. Peripheral blood smear. Yes, blood smear. Isme kya dekhenge hum? What we can see? Snake-like motility of the organism, trypomastigo. This is also done. If you want to further confirm, animal inoculation. Ek mice ko le lo, usme you just inject the blood sample and then wait for some days, again redraw the animal blood, then you can see what? The same organism, trypomastigote. Then after that, what? Very, very important, xenodiagnosis. Yes, what is a xenodiagnosis? In the uninfected redweed bug, that is a nymph stage. This point you have to remember, is we make the bug to feed. So it will feed. After 2 weeks, again, you can see this trypomastigote. Apart from that, intradermal test, PCR, ECG, endoscopy, then colonoscopy, all these are the investigatory tests. Yes? Are you all clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So what is the treatment? This is the last ending part. So treatment mein kya hai? So two drugs, it should be there in your mind. One is nifurtimox. How much we need to give? 8 to 10 milligrams per kg body weight, and depending on the whether it is child or adult, and it is usually given orally. This is the oral route. Yes, whereas if you just recollect our previous class for African sleeping sickness, there the drugs whatever we have given it, they are usually what? Parenteral, that is IV route. So here nifurtimox, it is given orally. Yes, for in 4 divided doses. That means 4 times in a day you have to give. For how many days, students? For 90 to 120 days. So what is the course over here? It is nearly 3 to 4 months you need to give. Like 3 to 6 months only you can ultimately say. So 90 to 120 days is what the duration of the treatment. Fine. What is another drug to be given? It is benznidazole. Benznidazole. It has to be given how much? Maybe 10 milligrams per kg body weight. For how many days we need to give? 60 days. That is a 3 months course. Yes, 2 months course we can give. So this is about the treatment. So 2 best drugs, and even if the newborn is infected also, same drugs only we give. But better is that the moment you identify baby as positive, give the treatment within how many days? Within 1 year. So this completes entire thing about what? Chagas disease, right? 7 o'clock, there is surgery class that will be taken by the Dr. Ramini. So make sure that you attend that class. So shall we all disperse, students?
Yes, ma'am.